and this is the Glide frame. So this frame is, it's a design that I've been working on for years at this point. It's been in the market for quite a while now, and I've been refining it along the way, and this is the most recent, most updated refinement. The probably most notable features of the update are that it has lock nuts for the arms finally, and it still doesn't have countersunk screws. I still don't like those. They still weaken the carbon quite a bit. However, on the back here, it does have 4 countersunk screws because it makes it much easier to mount your battery without a battery pad. I actually don't like running battery pads. I don't like adding that extra couple grams of rubber weight. And something else notable about this frame now is that there are 3 versions. This is actually the Glide Hammer, the heavy version that has 6mm arms with 2.5mm body plates through and through. And that's great, but what's really remarkable is that it's 115 grams. And even I couldn't believe that it came out to 115 grams. This design, or this heavy design, was inspired by Aaron Ciotti. I hope I said his name correctly, because he's been using my frames and he manages to just demolish frames. And so I put this together specifically for him because he kept asking me for stronger plates and stronger arms and stronger this. I'm like, well, you're just adding a bunch more weight and it's making it more risky to crash, because when you carry more weight into a crash, you're gonna break your frame or break something more easily than if you have something lighter. Now, this is the heavyweight version. The standard weight version has 5mm arms and 2mm plates with a chamfer on the arms. You notice that the 6mm, 2.5mm does not have a chamfer, because the chamfer actually does add a good amount of cost to the frame. And so you guys can chamfer it yourself if you like. You don't really need to. The edges are soft. They're not really sharp. Anyways, the regular version is now 97 grams. That's without these 4 screws in the middle. It includes the camera mount, but doesn't include these 4 screws in the middle. So this is 97 grams. And then there's also a lightweight version, which is 84 grams. And that's the most remarkable version for me, because that's my favorite version. In fact, I don't even run the lightweight version. It has 1.5mm plates and 4.5mm arms. And I'll talk about the flight performance of all these in a minute, but the version that I actually run is a version that I don't even sell. This has 1.5mm main body plates and 4mm arms. And it seems like I just don't crash that much, and this particular quad is my favorite quad by a long shot. It has the Amoxino 2305 motors in 1750 kV. I run it on 6S. It has the Mamba 6S ESC in there, and it has a Mamba flight controller up front as well, which there's a lot of good 20x20 flight controllers as well. And right up front, a real quick talk about my general build layout. And so I said at the beginning, it doesn't matter where you mount your flight controller, and that's because every time I show this frame or any of my designs or anything that I'm flying in any of my videos, I get probably at least 10 messages from people asking me why I put the flight controller off center and it should be. They don't ask me, they tell me I'm doing something so wrong, I shouldn't be putting the flight controller off center. And I've been doing this for years, for many years now, for at least 3 years, I don't put my flight controller in the middle. It just doesn't make sense to me, because it doesn't matter where you mount your flight controller. The reason why I build my quads like this is that, so the first time I separated things away from each other is I put the flight controller in the back, but then as I moved forward and designed this frame, I then started putting the flight controller in the front, and that's because the flight controller and camera are very sensitive to radio waves, and I like leaving my telemetry on my components, on my crossfire, and that's really what causes a lot of the interference with the onboard OSD chip on the flight controller as well as the camera. So the way I have it laid out here is that I have the camera and the flight controller up front, which there's plenty of room for. The actual final version is the prototype version. The final version actually has a couple more millimeters of room where in the front for the camera and the flight controller. And I put the ESC in the middle with the VTX on top of the ESC. And then I put my crossfire in the back with my antenna coming out the back and everything else coming out the back. The reason there's a notch here in the frame is specifically for your power cable to be able to go up through the frame more easily. And so somewhat shorter power cables will work out more nicely. Also, I mount my, this is not crossfire just because I built this quad with this R9 system in it and just left it, was too lazy to switch it out. I don't recommend R9 at all. Don't buy anything R9. I know it's cheap, it's just not worth your time at all. Anyways, I put my antenna in the middle here because it's just a really nice, convenient place to mount the antenna. And so it doesn't really get hit, it doesn't get damaged being mounted in the middle like this. And that really is nice for me because I don't have to worry about it. It's definitely not the most optimal position for radio waves. It's definitely not a good idea to mount things in the middle of all this stuff. But the Crossfire protocol is such a beautifully created protocol that it can tolerate these kinds of stupid, arguably, mounting positions that I have put it in. Anyways, moving on to the other features of the frame, let's just show you the 6mm version. So this version, like I said, is probably the most amazing version to me because it is only 115 grams for a 6mm thick arm, 2.5 millimeter body plate frame. And I mean, that's a real beefcake frame. I would be really surprised if somebody was able to demolish this frame the way Aaron Ciotti, he just wrecks frames inside out, just destroys them. I have a hard time believing that he's going to be able to destroy this frame in the same way that he's destroyed other frames. Anyways, something you may have noticed about the top plate is that there's a bunch of hole patterns up here because this three-hole pattern up here is a legacy GoPro mount pattern from the Floss Style and the original Flowride. And so if you have mounts from back then, they will fit this pattern. Also, there's a glide pattern that holds that connects to these four holes, and that mounts really nicely as well. The battery strap location up here, the way that's supposed to work is like this. So you actually weave the battery strap over that middle segment and it wraps around the sides, and that really holds the battery strap on really nicely, and it makes it really clean and neat when you do strap the battery on top. The battery straps are designed such that you will put the battery in and you will put this power lead through the first one, and then you can close the second one fully and then just plug and unplug your battery as necessary, and that makes it really convenient to use. One of the biggest things that I focus on my designs and everything that I do is convenience of use and making it so that it'll actually work for you and get out of your way so that you can fly and do what you want to do. Now, something you may have noticed is that there's a lot of mounting holes in the middle of this frame. That's because there's a plethora of ways to mount everything that you want. So in the middle here, there's a 30 by 30 mount, and there's also two 20 by 20 platforms, because some 20 by 20 ESCs are a little bit off center or a little bit bigger on one side. And in fact, I do expect 20 by 20 ESC, the board shape, to end up being similar sized to a 30 by 30 ESC board that they used to be, just with a 20 by 20 mount. I think the 20 by 20 mount is a far superior mount for a number of reasons I'm not going to get into, but there's two mounting options in the middle. There's also a 20 by 20 mount in the back and a 20 by 20 mount in the front. The front is intended for the flight controller. However, you don't have to use the flight controller in the front. You can mount anything anywhere you want. It just makes it really convenient to have all these mounting holes. One note I would make, put your center screws for your stack in before strapping on the bottom plate. And that's for a very specific reason. This bottom plate is designed very, very specially to hold up to forces in the diagonal direction. Something you may notice is that the carbon fibers are actually running diagonally compared to the main top plate. And this is also for a very specific reason. It gives it torsional rigidity in that direction. And so if I was to make these holes large enough to fit the screw heads through, it would significantly impact the strength of this lower portion of the frame. And in fact, if you do break this lower portion, it will break right around this bigger hole over here. I've tried to increase the strength here, but the problem with increasing the strength in this particular area is that I can bump this out as much as I want. The problem is that by putting this hole in the middle, I'm actually cutting the carbon fibers that are moving diagonally. So I can add as much as I want to the side here, but it's not actually traveling all the way down the carbon diagonal direction. So it's not really adding a whole lot to the strength and durability of it. I did do a little bit here just to give it a little bit of something, but that's the main reason why the holes aren't big enough to actually fit the entire screw head through. Something else you'll probably notice is that the arms here have nice, thick, wide butt joints up against each other, and that's to avoid the play in the arms. And as you use the frame, the first time you build the frame, you do have to thread the screws through the carbon completely, but the carbon will compress over time. And so this butt joint helps keep everything tight and firm throughout the lifespan of the frame. replacing an arm is really no problem at all anymore. It's two screws. One screw goes through the lock nut on top here, and the other screw goes through the standoff in the middle there. So you really only take out two screws. It is really easy to pull an arm out and put another screw in, no problem. The TPU mount in front here has two mounting positions. One thing I would point out is that this frame was designed a while ago, before the DJI system existed. There are some people that have been cramming the DJI system into this design. I don't know how they're getting it to work. I have seen some people just leave the rear standoffs off, or some people just not use these middle standoffs and just get it to fit. I'm not planning on altering this design to fit the DJI system. I do have another design that I'm working on, a more cinematic design, which I'll talk about for a moment at the end of this video. But the camera will fit for the DJI system, it's just the air unit won't fit. I do understand that Cadex is making an air unit that is a lot smaller, a 20 by 20 mount size, and that would be fantastic if you could just put it right here, right behind the camera, and then mount your flight control and everything else back there. This frame has a nice amount of space to build, and it's still a very small, constricted frame. Now, talking about the layout of the frame, it is a true X. Yeah, it is a true X, but it is a larger true X. So this frame is large enough to fit 6-inch props. However, only 5-inch will fit because of the long fuselage. So you don't need to run longer arms to be able to run a 6-inch size frame with, I mean, this is a pretty much standard at this point. Most freestyle frames are large enough to have to fit 6-inch props if they didn't have the center fuselage. The other reason why I forgot to mention, I'm not going to be lengthening the middle portion because that is the widest portion to be able to fit the air unit, is that if I was to change this middle segment, make it longer in any way, it would significantly impact the rigidity and the strength and durability of the structure of the design. Something about my designs is that I spend a ton of time refining as much as I can as a human. I have run it through, I have a friend at NASA that ran it through their structural analysis software, and it gave me some structural analysis help, but honestly, it just real life testing and watching how people break the design is far more useful than any kind of computational analysis of what may or may not break. It's really hard for it to really understand the way it's being used and the use forces. So this has been refined over years. And the other reason why this bottom segment is the shape and size and way it is because, as I just explained, I cannot lengthen the segment because I need to keep the carbon fibers running diagonally straight down the arms and all the way across the frame. And so the other reason why this bottom segment and the whole arm and bracing structure is designed the way it is to give the center of the frame rigidity such that the transmission of vibrations and everything are somewhat managed to some degree. So something more recently that we've learned, which we've all speculated for a long time, is that more rigid frames tend to perform better, mainly because the vibrations are more predictable in the system. So when you give your flight controller the RPM filtering, it knows what's happening with the motors and it knows what to expect from the motors. The problem is when you start getting resonance throughout the frame structure, that's when you need those notch filters and the dynamic filters and all that other stuff to come into play to help fix the flight system, fix the flight performance. It doesn't really improve anything, it just helps compensate for the lack of predictability in the structure. So this 6mm arm, 2.5mm design, the whole thing. This is the most rigid structure I have probably ever put together, and that is in a big part due to the fact that the carbon fibers in the center body are running diagonally to one another. The actual main body is going back and forth, and the lower bracing structure is going diagonally, and so those cross brace each other, not to mention the arms are bracing themselves against each other, and everything else is working really nicely together. So this particular version, the heavy version, has the most predictable vibration profile than the other ones. It is absolutely rigid and solid. As you move to the standard version, which is the version that I would really recommend for the every user, but I know that people look at a 115-gram frame and think, oh, that's a great weight, because the vast majority of acro frames out there are even heavier than 115 grams. So they think that's amazing, and so I'm giving you a 115-gram frame that's hella durable, for lack of a better term. And so the main version is 97 grams, and it is not quite as rigid as the 6mm, 2.5mm body version. However, it is still rigid enough to give you very predictable vibration profile in the structure of the frame. One thing I would note about the lightest version is that this is the most unpredictable version of vibration with respect to vibrations. It's the most unpredictable version of the three. However, I still have not seen any crazy resonance issues with this design, even when I turn off my when I turn off my notch filters and everything. But as you can see, it's actually really tough. I don't know if you can see it, but I can actually flex this frame a little bit in my hands when I'm holding it. And so it is still incredibly rigid and solid, and I haven't seen any issues. But if we are going to discuss vibrations, because that seems to be, in my opinion, what's going to be coming down the pipeline with respect to many other designs, I would point out that this is the least predictable one. However, the 84 gram frame weight is quite a weight savings off the 115 gram thick version. So that will impact flight performance. So now we're getting to this point where it's a little bit, you gotta balance what you're looking for. And this discussion is really probably overblown compared to what 99% of people out there think about when they're building these quads. They just throw everything on there and it flies great, and really anything you put on these frames will fly great. And it's only after flying these things for such a long time that you kind of look for these fine little refinements and changes and tweaks and little things that you like to run on your quads, because they help with the performance that you are looking for. And so with this kind of a setup, you do have to kind of balance how you want to run your flight controller firmware settings versus which frame you choose. Because this light version, while I have not had any problems at all, doesn't mean you're not gonna have problems. You may have some issues, you may have to even think about notch filter something or other, maybe, probably not, honestly. I'm really just blowing it out of proportions here, but it is something interesting to think about. But with the weight savings, you gain a significant improvement in flight performance. And I've said this time and time again, 580 grams all up weight for a 5-inch quad, acro quad, is the best flight performance overall that I have personally felt. A little bit lower weight is actually nice as well. However, the heftier size of the 580 grams, it really depends on the weight distribution of your setup. So while 580 grams is a really nice target number to hit, that's really most important for the throttle response and throttle feel. After that, it's the overall weight distribution of how much weight are you putting on the ends of the arms, how much weight are you loading in the middle, how tall are your standoffs, what is the general weight distribution of the entire quad. And that's the main reason why I don't actually like running a lot of TPU on any of my quads, especially not the TPU shoes on the end of the arms. And that is also a very good reason why I really, really like these 2305 motors on my own freestyle quad. This is like a 560 gram, 570 gram, not even, all up weight with a GoPro, everything on board. And the motors actually aren't that light. They're maybe only half a gram lighter than your typical 2306. They're 2305 motors, but they have really great response and everything is really great about them. And you don't really need that extra height in the motor when you have this low of a weight. You don't need that pop of power. And so it's really well balanced for the build setup. So balancing your build and the performance, I'll talk about that more in a later video, but basically know that the more weight you put on the ends of the arms, the more it impacts your flight performance. And having more weight densely packed in the middle with very, very light arm ends is how you improve your flight performance. So you can have a 570, 580, 800 gram all-up weight quad. As long as your arm ends are very, very light, you're still gonna have really great performance. You're not gonna get a lot of prop wash. You're gonna have really good control feel. And that's because the weight in the center is all centered in the middle. So when the quad rotates, it still doesn't have to work very hard to manage all the weight in the middle. 23 millimeter standoffs is what I run on my frames, because that just makes building things so much easier than even 20 millimeters. You can change them out to 20 millimeters if you want. However, you're gonna struggle to fit a micro camera in there. Nowadays we have nano cameras, and actually the Runcam Nano 3 is awesome. I would even consider running the Nano 3 in a 5-inch frame. It's that good. It's using the same sensor as, or the same size sensor as the Nano cameras and micro cameras, so it's really not worse performance, and the lens on it is really remarkably good. Okay, that's enough. I've touched on that stuff. I'm gonna touch on a couple other things. So this particular layout is a dead cat layout, and I do have the dead cat arms available on the FPV cycle as well for all of the frames, 6mm, 5mm, and 4.5mm. You can mix and match as you wish, but the dead cat arms, they're exactly, I can pull the camera out a little bit more, they're exactly what they sound like. They are just wide front arms to get the props out of view of the GoPro. And if you're running a session, or actually if you're running a session, you still need about 20 plus degrees. This is too much, this is not necessary, it's more like this. You still need about 20 degrees of tilt to be able to get the props out of view with the dead cat arms. But I found that dead cat arms actually don't impact flight performance all that much. It really is just a touch of performance difference. There's still a good amount of separation between, not a good amount, well, there's some separation between the front and back props. And I'm not going to get into that. It's a long discussion in itself. Another way you can set it up is like this. So I have swapped this frame to have the dead cat arms in the back rather than the front, because I was using this quad as a follow cam. So I had my session in the back here, and I was recording as somebody was skateboarding or biking or whatever behind me, and that worked out really nice. And I just decided to do that on the spot because the arms are so quick and easy to swap that I just swapped the front and back arms. So I think I've talked enough about everything. It's been a long enough video for now. If you guys want videos about just the general setup of the quad and how I think things should be set up to get optimal performance, let me know in the description in the comments below. It's very personal how people set up their quads and how they want. It's very personal what frame they want to run. Generally, I don't recommend ready-to-fly quads. You're never going to get exactly what you want in a ready-to-fly build from any company. They never build it as you want to build it yourself. I've tried to work with companies to get a frame with the electronics set up in the frame, already built, ready to go, and sell just the frame with the electronics with no motors and props, because ultimately, at this point in time, pretty much all flight controllers fly the same. I know that there's some new ones on the horizon. We've got one coming as well. It doesn't really have any technical advantages, but it is just really easier to use. I do know that there are a couple of different technical improvements that are coming down the line. Some things with multiple gyros, some things, actually the guy from Clean Flight is making something as well. So there are things coming. At this point, things fly really, really great, and it's very easy to just pick components that are pretty reliable and then just put that in a frame ready to go, because really just wiring up your electronics is what takes most of the time. After that, it's just screwing on the motors and soldering them up, and it's really not a big deal. So if you get that electronic things figured out, then it's really easy to just put your motors on, because everything else is, electronics are pretty standardized at this point. They all kind of work pretty well. It's just whatever you like to use because you've set up that version the most. Motors and props are really what impact the flight performance a little bit more than the electronics that you use. Anyways, that's it for now. Don't forget to floss your teeth. Flossing is very important. Another thing I would point out about 5-inch in general is that I don't know if it's just the holidays or the winter or what it is, but 5-inch just doesn't seem to be quite as popular as it once was. Not popular as in people using them. Many people are using them. It's just people aren't buying 5-inch stuff as much or as quickly as they once were. And I think that's probably because we kind of hit a plateau where things are pretty even. Like, there's really no advancements coming out. I know there's a new motor coming from Newbie Drone, which is pretty interesting, pretty unique. There's another one coming from iFlight. This it's called the Cyber Motor. It's really awesome looking, but I don't know if that's really going to be any notable improvement. It does have a 10mm bearing in it. I have been pushing for bigger bearings and 5-inch motors for a while now. I've been trying to work on a 12mm bearing version myself, but it's just so hard to re-engineer the entire motor. Other than that, there's some flight controller improvements, but I mean, where else is there to go? I mean, things fly so awesome at this point, it's really hard to go anywhere else. But these flight controller improvements will improve reliability and maybe improve some of the things a touch as well. There are some new ESC codes coming out. There is FET tech, has a new one wire protocol that I think KISS has implemented already that I hope comes to Betaflight, because that's freaking awesome when you, if you only need one signal wire to run all of your ESCs and everything. So it's only three wires from the ESC to the flight controller. That's a signal wire, power, and a ground, which is amazing. And but none of these things are going to actually improve flight performance. They are all great and they're all conveniences that are wonderful, but I don't know if that's going to bring people back to 5-inch. Now, what I'm working on is the cinematic stuff, and I'm not going to show you the design right now. Some people have seen it. I've been testing it a lot, and I've been sharing it with some people. The cinematic quad is what I was flying in the previous video with a very low flying, and not the Tiny Hawk, the one before that. And it's actually, the camera's not mounted low at all. It's actually higher up on the frame than any other frame that I've ever built or ever shown. It's just that the way the frame is set up makes it so much easier to fly low to the ground that it makes it really, really nice to fly. And the powertrain and everything that I mentioned in that video in the text is really what makes it so easy to fly and makes it capable of such easily cinematic type footage. And I really didn't do much in that video. I just cruising up and down the street. I didn't do anything at all, and it got so much attention that I wasn't really expecting. So yeah, I'm gonna share more on that a little bit later. Anyways, take care, floss your teeth, bye bye.